Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. This should be a very interesting event. Before another interesting event, we'll all get home in time for the debate. But, of course, there's another debate that's been going on for 30 years between the United States and Iran. And many commentators have said that this issue, the issue of Iran and the United States, will be one of the most important, if not the most important, foreign policy issue that the next president will face. We are very honored to have here at the Council the foreign minister of Iran, who is literally on his way out the door after this session. But he has graciously agreed to come here and speak with us today. Manouchehr Mottaki is a career diplomat for Iran. He has previously served as Iran's ambassador to Turkey and ambassador to Japan. He's also been a deputy foreign minister. And he received his BA in India at Bangalore University and an MA in international relations from Tehran University. And if I may, I'll invite him up right now. I believe he wants to make a few introductory remarks, and then we'll turn to Q&A. Thank you.
In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I thank the organizers for the opportunity given to me to talk in a friendly environment, in a sincere fashion. And I need to thank you, ladies and gentlemen. One of the more important issues that today do you have translation, ladies and gentlemen?
Yes.
Very good. Mazrat mekham, befarmid. Today we are talking about the issue of power and responsibility. I think that the root cause of many problems today has to do with the irresponsible behavior by power. If we are to define a rational relationship between power and responsibility, if we are to talk about that, power can be in the service of humanitarian goals, and it can help to bring about a life which enjoys peaceful coexistence. Finally, peace, stability, and justice. The nature of power, well, it does not like to accept responsibility. Unfortunately, international frameworks cannot establish the necessary mechanism so that power becomes responsible and answerable. The new event which is taking shape and happening has everything to do with the change in the nature of power. So far, military might, economic might, war, the main indicators which power has utilized to have influence. Today, we are facing a soft, if you will, movement leading to a change in the nature of power. In other words, simultaneous with technological improvements and development, we see a soft power emerging in international relations. And as I see it, this is very important. In my point of view, different to times in the past, when we used to have military challenges, arms race, well, we don't have those things to contend with anymore. The main challenge today has to do with a challenge between ideas and rationales, reasoning, if you will. And we think that many of today's powers that because of their military might and other capabilities were seriously, well, they met with failure in their foreign policy. They are facing serious failures. The main reason is they cannot persuade the international public opinion. And this lack of acceptable logic is creating a new environment when it comes to international relations. Aside from this, I refer to two other events. One is good news, the other bad news. Later, I will take your questions, ladies and gentlemen. The good news is that the 20-month crisis in Lebanon, fortunately, has been resolved, and a regional solution and a collective political will have brought about good results, again relating to the Doha meeting or conference. Before you, you see different reactions or interactions when it comes to the problems inside Lebanon. Some of the approaches taken failed. For example, the head of one particular state woke up one morning, issued dictates saying that Lebanese MPs and should determine the next president of the republic. And this, again, half of the number of the MPs plus one, that formula, or other similar efforts for Lebanon in the past 2 years. The Islamic Republic of Iran helped some of those efforts. But what finally helped to resolve the Lebanese problem was the Doha talks and a Lebanese consensus helping to find a resolution. I remember it was 2:30 in the morning of the day of negotiations. I was called and told that the negotiations have reached an impasse. Now, 2:30, Mr. Amr Musa, the Secretary General of the Arab League, has left. Can you hear the translator's voice? Oh, well, please bear with me. I'm going to ask one of the technicians to help me with this. As I was saying, Mr. Amr Musa left Doha And some of the delegations were leaving or intending to leave Doha. 2:30 in the morning until 9 in the morning. Qatari officials, Lebanese officials, and other officials from other capitals in the region, we called them over the phone, contacted them. After 7 hours, we managed to bring the negotiations back on track. 24 hours later, the negotiations paid off, so to speak, and the Lebanese people celebrated. Many foreign dignitaries, officials, including the Minister for Foreign Affairs of the Islamic Republic of Iran, were invited to attend. And we were happy that we have to live and work with one less crisis in the region. After a few months had passed, another crisis happened in my part of the world, and that is the Caucasus crisis. I think if we are to find the root cause of the problem in the Caucasus, we have to talk about the reasons that contributed to that incident. How did it happen? And where are we standing right now? And what will the repercussions be for the region and other parts of the world? Undoubtedly, the region will be affected, and for some time, from this crisis. Important issues such as energy, transportation, and finally, security in the region have been adversely affected. The first violation had to do with the use of force to resolve a problem. This action, based on wrong information and a miscalculation, happened. Nobody perhaps would have thought that Russia would react the way it did. But this reaction happened nevertheless. Many parties, people, tried their very best to control the crisis. The Islamic Republic of Iran, as a country which neighbors two countries in the Caucasus, started an effort. I went to Moscow myself, later to Georgia, later still to Baku, and I played host to the Minister for Foreign Affairs of Armenia later, and also met my German counterpart in the city of Berlin. My personal impression is that the root causes of the crisis still exist. Aside from the issue of the use of force, the second point which is important has to do with the territorial integrity of the country. Naturally, when we talk about these principles, such as the not using force or territorial integrity of states, this cannot, well, no one can deal in double standards when it comes to these principles. In Europe, one cannot disrespect the territorial integrity of states. But in another part of the world, ask others to respect the very same thing. Therefore, some of the pundits believe that the action and the events inside Ossetia and Abkhazia, in other words, the declaration of independence in those two regions, had something to do with the independence of Kosovo. If such a hypothesis is correct, then the other components of the crisis in the Caucasus must have their own particular responses. For example, if in the second day of the crisis an agreement for the missile shield was signed in Poland, in response to that event, where should we expect it to happen, to come about? In Syria, in Venezuela, or in another part of the world? So, I am referring to these. I want to demonstrate that the crisis inside the Caucasus is a crisis which, unfortunately, as I said earlier, the root causes are still there. We have started a regional effort. Simultaneously, we have approached Europe as well on the subject. And we are hoping, well, from inside these debates, exchanges of view, efforts, a mechanism arise helping with cooperation. In any case, we are facing and contending with this problem in our part of the world. My last comment deals with the obligation on the part of the Islamic Republic of Iran. We will provide serious assistance to help find resolutions to regional crises. If you consider the foreign policy of the Islamic Republic of Iran, our performance, in the past years, you will see that the Islamic Republic of Iran has continuously worked to find resolutions to problems. Aside from the inappropriate behavior or responses received in despite these efforts, despite double standards, dealings with similar phenomena in our part of the world. Saddam engaged in two sets of attacks, aggression in the Persian Gulf. One, waging war against the Islamic Republic of Iran and later Kuwait. And the way the UNSC dealt with that aggression, once you put these side by side, your first impression, I am sure, will be that in one case they have supported the aggressor. In another case of aggression, they have come to support the country which was attacked. So, the capabilities of the Islamic Republic of Iran as a country which is interested in justice, peace, stability will be utilized to help find resolutions for regional problems. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your patience, for your interest. I thank the Madam Facilitator, and I am now ready to take your questions. Thank you.
I neglected to tell everyone to please turn off your cell phones or all other buzzing materials. And also, I have been informed that the remarks of the minister will be on the record, not off the record, as stated in the program, unless he specifies that that's on particular record.
I want to start again by thanking you for being here, and I have the great pleasure of being able to ask you a couple of questions before we open it up to the floor. خودم میپرسم قبل از اینکه از فلور سوال دریافت کنیم.
The last time that we met was in July, I believe. You came to the United Nations and you invited a bunch of journalists to have lunch with you, which was very nice. And you said at the time, quote, "The first word diplomats learn is compromise." Do you remember?
یادتون هست؟
Compromise.
Compromise.
مصالحه.
And,
بله.
And you suggested
و همچنین
that Iran was willing to accept what's known as the freeze for freeze proposal. That Iran would suspend
adding
centrifuges.
دیگر اضافه نکند به تعداد سانتریفیوژها حداقل
برای 6 هفته و بدین ترتیب And the Bush administration got very excited and they sent Undersecretary of State Bill Burns to Geneva to sit down with Mr. Jalili, your chief nuclear negotiator. There was a lot of expectation that there might be a breakthrough. But you haven't accepted freeze for freeze. Nothing has changed. Does Iran reject this idea completely, or have you simply given up on negotiations while the Bush administration is in office?
زمانی که بوش در قدرت است از مذاکره امتناع می کنید. Well, one of the words when it comes to the Islamic Republic of Iran you hear repeatedly is justice. Justice means a balanced compromise. Therefore, the previous word, I am forced to define it again so that there are no misunderstandings. When it comes to our legal activities and peaceful nuclear activities, we are going about our business, so to speak. And the technical agency of the United Nations in this regard is the IAEA. And more than any other state so far, we have cooperated with the agency. And a witness to this claim is the agency itself. They have talked about certain issues. They have put to us their questions, ambiguities. 1.5 years ago, here in this forum and in other places, I announced that we are ready to answer all questions, to do away with all misgivings, concerns, ambiguities. And the agency they informed different parties that if they have any questions, they should give them to the agency. Naturally, the U.S. gave many questions to the agency, talked about different misgivings, ambiguities. In accordance with our agreement with the agency, we responded one by one to those questions. And the agency later, in a written fashion, they wrote a letters to us stating that what Iran has given us, information Iran has provided to us, is correct. This, for all practical purposes,
Mr. Minister, with all due respect,
Therefore, we answered all the questions that the agency had. We took another huge step. We said, we announced that we are ready to start a comprehensive cooperation. Mr. Solana later came to Tehran and proposed a package. He submitted a letter by the six ministers to me and a non-paper which dealt with the modality of the negotiations. In that modality, the point which you referred to earlier is there. Negotiations in three stages. The first stage, without preconditions. Entrance into the second stage, as you said earlier, 6 weeks. The precondition for that was freeze for freeze. Later, a third stage. Entrance to that stage, the precondition was suspension. Now, based on this, the Geneva talks started because we also, well, earlier we had submitted our own non-paper or modality for the negotiations. Our agreement with Mr. Solana in Tehran was that in the talks, we are going to agree on a common modality. Therefore, one party was not supposed to answer to the other party. The talks went ahead. Mr. William Burns participated in the talks. We were told that the gentleman represents the President of the U.S. in the talks, and at the highest levels offices in my country, we welcomed this initiative. Therefore, whenever a correct action is taken by the U.S., we will not ignore. But my substantial talk here has to do with the fact that Mr. Solana was told that you know no one in Iran will accept suspension. And the gentleman said, yes, I know that nobody in Iran will approve of suspension. Let us talk over another phase. And talks on another stage is ongoing. We have submitted our own modality, as you understand. In the Iranian modality, what we have there says or talks about agreed action. This relates to a agreement between the two parties to take a practical step. We remain true to our own modality. Therefore, at the moment, Mr. Solana is supposed to give us a new modality, and set aside the whole request for suspension. So what remains is freeze for freeze. There are other ideas which have been tabled in the past 2 years, such as a pause or the rate of growth or increase or some other ideas. In the context of these talks, we can reach an agreed point. This can be anything. What remains carries the same weight as this agreed point.
Realistically, though, are there going to be talks before our elections, before we have a new president announced? And isn't Iran looking toward the next administration?
Everyone is looking and following the American elections.
Let's make you free from this translation, and maybe you will be more patient to follow my real English, but it's more direct, I think. Everybody is looking to the U.S. election, and
because everybody is considering, I mean all the parties, different countries are considering what will be the next policy of the United States. In this question itself, we can find some criticize of ongoing policies in the United States. That's why, in our understanding, the next president in the United States has no choice but to follow sincere and substantial development or changes in the U.S. future policies. Policies towards Latin America, policies towards Middle East, policies towards Iraq, towards Afghanistan, and towards Iran, of course.
So the answer is yes, you are waiting for the next administration, which seems perfectly reasonable, frankly, to all of us here. I'll ask you one more nuclear question, and if I may, I want to open it up to the floor very quickly. And that is that there has been a suggestion, in fact, President Ahmadinejad at the breakfast that I attended last week mentioned that Iran had proposed an international consortium on Iranian soil to enrich uranium, and that Iran had proposed this 3 years ago. Is this still something that Iran would consider favorably? It's been mentioned in Track 2 discussions recently.
As President answered to this question in the meeting which you have referred to, yes, we can consider that proposal if anything is there, any proposal is there from different parties. But it does not mean that we stop ongoing, peaceful, and legitimate activities which we have in our country.
Okay. If I may, with the indulgence of the audience, since your answers were rather long, just ask you a couple of other quick things. There's been a lot of talk about opening a U.S. interest section in Tehran. If the U.S. makes a formal request, this administration, the Bush administration, will Iran agree?
I think realizing of the word of if in United States takes a lot of time, because it is 6 months, we are under question if United States raised such request. And yet we have not faced with raising such a request. Till now, everything was through the mass media, mm-hmm. and the mass median base answer also you have received. Let be a little bit patient, and if we receive such request, then we will answer.
Okay. No hypothetical questions for you. One other that's very important and has also been in the news, our ambassador in Iraq, Ryan Crocker, complained bitterly this week that Iran is trying to influence the Iraqi government not to accept a new status of forces agreement with the U.S., a new memorandum of understanding. Doesn't Iran want to keep the country stable, in which case presumably you would want to see American troops remain a little bit longer, yeah?
It is familiar to Iran that anywhere U.S. policy is failed in our region, they are looking for some party, some third parties, or some countries, some group to refer to them and put the responsibility on their shoulders. We don't know how to behave with different critical approach of the U.S. administration. One day, we are requested to sit and negotiate for Iraq. We have followed. One day, some commanders say that situation is better, good improvement is taking place, and Iran has cooperated with Iraq. The other day, something else. One day, Mr. Gates says something. But what is the truth? 6 years your forces are there. More than 100, 120,000, 130,000 forces there. Just three months after starting the war in Iraq, Mr. Bush said the war is over in Iraq.
I get your point about
yes,
the United States
about,
blaming others,
about
but
the
question
security
is about
agreement.
MOU.
Security
about
agreement.
Security
U.S. has made hostage Iraq under the seventh chapter of the United Nations just for imposing such will against Iraq. If the people on the streets and the officials in the government, in the parliament, and anywhere, and the religious leader very openly and clearly opposed to this imposing of the agreement, then we do believe the U.S. administration should follow the realities. What's going on there? And we were asked, what's your opinion? I said, we as a country in the region, our understanding is this. That doesn't mean that it is Iran's position. That's Iraq's position, and you have so many security agreements with the other countries. But in a stable and normal situation, you sign agreement with different countries. Why there is such a force in some very critical circumstances with which the official of Iraq from any parties say that insisting on signing of this agreement will make differences among the officials there in Iraq? These are the realities which in our understanding should be considered and take to consideration of the U.S. administration.
One more, and then I promise
yes,
I'll
sir.
Open it up. Where is Muqtada Sadr? Is he in Iran, and if so, where?
Now I don't know, but sometimes he was in Iran.
Okay.
For time being, I don't know.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, please raise your hand, wait for a microphone, identify yourselves if you would, And let's begin with the lady in front here.
Hi, thank you. Dr. Sherry Fink, ProPublica. Mr. Foreign Minister, I'd like to ask you about the detention of two internationally known HIV/AIDS physicians, the brothers Dr. Kamiar and Arash Alai, without charges in Elvin Prison's Section 209. I understand that doctors around the world have been calling for their release, and I wanted to ask you, with threats from disease that cross borders so easily, what does their detention mean or signal for Iran's engagement in the global public health arena, and are there plans to release the doctors? Thank you.
This is a question which was raised when my president was here and he instructed to consider the situation. I do not have any information in details. Generally, I can tell you that all the Iranian citizens are equal in front of law, and nobody will be arrested. But to break the law, but what is the reason for such arresting which you have referred to, I have to consider. I have no details.
I raised that question with President Ahmadinejad last week at a breakfast at the UN, and he said he would look into it. Yes, gentleman here on the end.
Thank you. Prem Kumar with the Council on Foreign Relations. Mr. Foreign Minister, what is Iran's view of the peace negotiations that are currently underway between Syria and Israel? And if the two parties were able to reach an agreement, how do you think Iran's relationship with Syria might change?
We do support strongly returning back the Golan.
To Golan,
to Syria, that is Syrian territories, as we do believe that the Shab'a farm should be returned to Lebanon and the other part of the Palestine to Palestinians. And this is our very clear position to support Syria for taking back its territory, which was occupied by the Israeli regime.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Minister, in that light, there was a proposal by the Bahraini foreign minister that got some attention. He suggested a regional security forum that would include Iran, Turkey, and Israel, along with Arab countries. I wondered if that's something that Iran could imagine attending.
Yeah, I have a close relation with my brother, Sheikh Khaled, but I don't consider such a proposal has the potential to be realized in the region. If you consider the regional groups in Middle East, in none of them Israel is as a member. And usually Israeli's regime is participating in some other regional group because nobody will accept this regime as a part of the region in the reality.
But if Israel returned the Golan and there was a Palestinian state, would Iran's position change?
Yesterday, I met Secretary General Mr. Ban Ki-moon, and I followed what my president discussed with Mr. Ban Ki-moon about our position towards Middle East and our plan for a root-based solution to the situation. In the Middle East, our position is very clear. Iran did not accept it or did not recognize two regimes after Islamic Revolution in Iran. Those two regimes, one apartheid regime in South Africa, and the next one, the Israeli regime in Palestine. And after removing of the apartheid regime in South Africa, we reestablished and resumed our diplomatic and good relations with South African current regime. And in the Middle East, we do not recognize still, and we will not recognize this regime. You know our elaboration, our explanation on this issue.
I'm
not going to take time.
I know. But yeah. I asked you a theoretical or hypothetical question, and you wouldn't bite. So we'll go back to the audience. Yes, Megan.
Megan O'Sullivan, Harvard's Kennedy School. Hello, Mr. Minister, and thank you for speaking with us tonight. As you may know, there's some debate among those of us who follow Iran closely about whether the Iranian government would in fact accept an offer from a new administration for dialogue without preconditions. So my question to you is, are you in a position to state definitively here that the Iranian government would accept the offer of a dialogue from a new administration if there were not preconditions attached?
Thank you very much for your question. Till now, usually the former presidents or foreign ministers of the United States made some statement and raised some proposal, very nice, and looking for a better relations with Iran, and also the candidates who are on the way of the White House, they say time to time they raise some position, and we take note those position and the nice words and some proposal, maybe constructive, but they are not in the administration. We have no way but to look to the White House. Despite of some very small changes in some areas, we don't see any serious changes in the White House. Then, you are asking about the new administration. All right, let's look to the new administration. In my understanding, U.S. needs a real reconsideration of its policies toward different areas, as I said earlier. If we see such a change, not in speaking or talking, taking practical steps and showing the seriousness. Since last 30 years, we have shown that any positive step will be responded by the counter positive step. Some of the audience here, they have the memory of Iran's participation for taking some step in Lebanon to solve some problems 1980s or beginning of 1990s, and Iran's position towards Afghanistan, Iran's position even when Mr. Burns participated in Geneva talk, you have seen our reaction. It shows that in a based on respected manner, Iran is in the position to consider seriously any constructive approach from the other side.
Yes, in the front.
Mary Boyce, You mentioned that when you need to deal with the United States, you look to the White House. Our Secretary of State reports to the White House, and we know precisely where the decisions are made. In your country, we are sometimes a bit confused. Can you help us understand whether your instructions come from the Supreme Leader, your President, some combination, some other group? And if there should be a disagreement, whose instructions do you follow?
If you consider the Iranian constitution, you will answer very easily for your question. In Iran, the position, authorization, and responsibilities of the officials are very clear. The most important thing is for the main topics and issues related to the national interest of our country, always you have seen consensus-based approach from Iran. Why am emphasizing on this? To prevent any misunderstanding. During previous government, some in the West believed that we should work in Iran with a part of the governing and ignore the other parts. We have to concentrate on this group and ignore the other group. 8 years they have followed that policy. During President Khatami's time, suspension of uranium, of enrichment, took place. But please do not forget, at the same period when President Khatami was in power, we have stopped suspension and the start enrichment. It shows that suspension was a national interest based decision which took place, and the stopping of suspension also was through the same policy. Now, after Khatami, another mistake is taking place. And again, some believe that we can concentrate on a part of the ruling in Iran and ignore the other part in Iran. That will not reach to any answer. We in Iran may have different opinion, which is quite normal everywhere in the world. But for the basic and vital issues in my country, everybody stands on the same common and consensus-based position. I have a lot of examples for that, which I'm not going to take your time.
Yes, in the middle.
Susan Woodward from the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. Yes. Most of your discussion has been on your western border, could we move to your eastern border? And what you propose for stabilization in Afghanistan and Pakistan?
Very good and interesting question. Thank you very much. We see a lot of concern on Afghanistan. We consider very shaky situation in Afghanistan. When I am talking about concern, please take note that it is not a concern for our country own, our own country. We have learned since last 30 years how to live safe among the crises which surrounded Iran. I'm not talking about the concern of Iran. I am talking about a regional concern. And that is extremism. The scenario which we understand today is to do second, to repeat for second time, a strategic mistake in their behavior with extremism in the region. Some believe, I'm not talking about the United States, some specific European partner in Afghanistan. They are working now and considering for the possible returning of extremism in power in Afghanistan. The only condition which they put is not to affect West or Europe, if I may say. This is a dangerous. Why? Because extremism has no border. Yesterday it was in Afghanistan. And today in Pakistan you hear Pakistani Taliban. Talibanization is going to become a culture there. If yesterday was in Afghanistan and today in Pakistan, where will be tomorrow? India?
Mr. Minister.
And after India, China? And then where?
Mr. Minister, sorry. You've said you want American troops out of Iraq.
Yes.
Do you want American troops out of Afghanistan, or do you support the idea of sending more troops there to try to stabilize the situation?
Another good question.
Towards
Iraq, we see some improvement since last 6 months. But we should take care. Some parties are making propaganda that is because of increasing the number of the foreign troops to Iraq. That's not true. The reason is giving back the files of ruling of Iraq, particularly the security files, and the good management of the Iraqi government in combating with terrorism. This is our consideration. This is our analysis. If it is so, it is the best time for U.S. and the foreign forces in Iraq to propose a plan for withdrawal from Iraq. This is what I mentioned in Sharm el-Sheikh, in Istanbul, and in Kuwait. Situation in Afghanistan is more complicated. And we do believe that it is necessary to prepare a new roadmap, regional-based approach, and of course, parallelly with the other main parties who are related with Afghanistan, because in Afghanistan, presence of the foreign troops are based on resolution by the Security Council. The nature of the presence of foreign troops is different than Iraq. And that's why what is necessary, rearrangements for preparation of a new roadmap toward Afghanistan. And Iran several times mentioned that is in the position to give its consultations, cooperation, and we are doing by ourselves. Three main problems are there in Afghanistan: security problem, narcotic problem, and the differences among the coalition government there. That is another dangerous. The competitors among the coalitions who cannot take place or be replaced for Mr. Karzai. For time being, we do not see any alternative for Mr. Karzai there. But they are in the position to prevent some happening in Afghanistan. That's why situation is complicated, very shaky, and a lot of concern is there. 3 weeks ago, we have been in China with my president, and we could see the concern from Chinese also. India is concerned, Central Asia is concerned, Russia and the others in the region. And I do believe that the West should be concerned. Those who started negotiation with the leader of the extremism in Musa Qal'e and continuing now in the European capitals, they are responsible for any problem which may face the region and out of the region in Afghanistan.
I've heard this, yes. I think we're out of time. If somebody has one more urgent question, I'll take it. If not, we will thank the minister very much for his time.
Thank you.
Been an absolutely fascinating discussion. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.